Good evening, Nappinai. I got it right?
Good evening, and yes, you did.
I did. I drilled it into myself.
Yes.
Okay, it's a pleasure to have you here for the 85th episode of Jam with Sam, hosted by Neural Maven. So tell us, where did you grow up, and something about your school, college education, and where did you complete your law firm, in that order?
Yeah, okay. Thank you for having me here, firstly. I'm a Chennai girl.
Chennai
girl. So I'm from the south, grew up in what was then called Madras.
Yes.
Right? And schooling was in initially Shrine Velankanni, which was a co-ed school. And my grandmother, at when I was about 5 years old, thought I shouldn't be in a co-ed school and moved me to Vidyodhya Girls Higher Secondary School. Emphasis on girls.
Okay.
And then college was Law College. Tamil Nadu was the first to introduce the five-year course.
Okay.
Even before the national law schools came into play.
Okay.
So for a brief while, I was in Etiraj, and then I got my admission and I moved to law straight from school. And then a lawyer from there. I practiced in Chennai, in fact, for nearly 10 years and then moved to Bombay.
Okay. What is one thing you remember from school, college days?
You know what? I always thought I was a very naughty child.
Huh.
And now people
contrast,
tell me.
Contrast, yeah, contrast.
And now when people, you know, but when people meet me now, they say, oh, you were so studious. You will always be found in the library and all. It was a little disappointing to be told that I was studious.
Okay. So appearances are deceptive.
Even assumptions are deceptive here.
Yeah, I'm speaking to a lawyer over here. I should know that. Okay. So you did a course in mediation from World Intellectual Property Organization. So just tell us about it.
I believe in serendipity. A lot of things have happened to me, you know, by the way kind of thing. It was just serendipity. Mediation was something like that too. So the first jurisdiction, so to say, which introduced mediation in India was Bombay High Court.
Okay.
And that was in 2003. I was part of the first panel of mediators who were trained by the court, and then we started working in this. My specialization being intellectual property rights and cyber laws, I also wanted to do a specialized mediation program in this field.
Okay.
So therefore, I went to WIPO. I did both. I still had to redo the basic mediation training, though I had already trained twice in India. But I did the basic and advanced back to back. It was a fabulous experience. And you know, you get to pitch yourself against the best from across the world. And I personally feel that apart from undertaking work as a mediator, it has also helped me immensely, one, in my practice, and two, as a person. Because you learn, the first rule they teach you in mediation is put yourself in the shoes of the other person.
Okay.
Look at things from the other person's perspective and then see whether you would still want what you were asking for. So when you apply those rules in everyday life, you just automatically become a better person.
Okay. Mediation will teach husband and wife also some good things.
Definitely. So before you get into trouble and then go for mediation, maybe you should go and do a course before.
Who should go, the husband or the wife?
Okay, both. Both.
Both.
But just don't go to the same mediation program.
Okay. You did a postgraduate in cybersecurity and cyber policies from Cranfield University. Tell us about that.
So this was part of Chevening Fellowship, which is sponsored by the UK Foreign Commonwealth Office, FCO. So this was in 2016.
Okay.
So along with the fellowship, they also give you the option of completing a PG certificate program in cybersecurity and cyber governance and all.
Okay.
Cyber laws being my specialized field. And around that time, I'd already started doing a lot of work on policy also.
Okay.
Which I'm doing currently too. So I'm primarily involved even in the law making, not just the law implementation process. So it was a fantastic experience. It was at the Defense Academy, which is coincidentally also part of the Cranfield University.
Okay.
So it was a fantastic experience.
Okay. And recently you did your Stanford CDRL Fellowship on Democracy, Development and Rule of Law.
Yeah, that's exactly what CDDRL stands for.
Okay.
So yes, Stanford was brilliant. So you know, as a child, as a student, I've always wanted to study abroad. And I do come from a middle class background. It's not that easy for us to just, I mean, in our time, we didn't have student loans and things like that to facilitate it. And I'm kind of like maybe living the dream of the child now. But Stanford was a leadership program.
Okay.
I really got to meet amazing leaders from across the world, interact with them and find out what are the kind of conflicts and problem situations that people are in. I'm telling you, we lead a very cushy life in
here?
India.
Yeah.
Yeah. We really don't know when a good thing is going for us. You know, you have to see what's happening outside to know what a fabulous life we are leading here. But just not just being exposed to that, but being able to contribute. We would have sessions, we would have classes, but we'd also have brainstorming sessions and role plays and case studies. So each of it actually lends itself to you becoming again a better leader and a better person.
So these are only for a particular kind of field of people, kids across industries?
Oh well, this was not for lawyers. It's just for leaders.
Okay.
The Stanford program was for leaders.
And you're selected for that?
Yes, yes. It's supposed to be a very tough selection process.
Okay. And you have to pay for it?
No, it's not. It's a fellowship.
Fellowship. I want more. We all want more fellowships.
Yes, I love these fellowships.
Totally nice. I think Elsa is really living her dream because every month she's in a different, fellowship here, there. I keep seeing her. She's hardly
in
India.
She is like our mentor. She is the ideal.
Ideal.
We are looking up to on that.
Okay. Fun times. If you are a dictator of a small country, what crazy dictator things would you like to do?
Firstly, he thinks I look like a dictator. Two, I only get a small country. Why not at least a big country?
The big country is all taken already.
Oh, okay. Touché.
Touché.
So, you know, it's in my DNA, liberty, democracy and all. So, when I think about it, I think Charlie Chaplin was mentioned earlier. So I think I'll be like the Charlie Chaplin kind of dictator.
Achha.
The barber one, not the real dictator even in that movie. So I think I'll be the kind who will probably, he's supposed to have given a speech on liberty and democracy and all that. So maybe I'll do it and still try and figure out how I can make people laugh.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So, laughter would still be the best medicine for me, dictator or not.
If you had to erase one thing from existence, the memory also of that thing, what would that be?
Literally nothing.
Literally nothing?
Yeah. Even the worst of things that happen in our life actually lend themselves to
mosquitoes.
Our growth. No, no, even mosquitoes are good. It's if you don't have mosquitoes around, how will you know what life is like without them?
Oh, God. Okay, coming to professional career, how has your journey been in the field of law and what are the top three things which you're proud of in the last 28 years?
Yeah, 28, yeah. Nearly 29 now. Okay. Yeah. So it's been a long journey. It's had its great times, tough times, everything. So I started my practice in Chennai. I finished nearly about 9.5 years of practice there and then moved to Bombay. So I always claim that I'm very lucky.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had a great beginning in Chennai. Practice grew, technically I was a first generation lawyer.
Oh,
because
okay.
The gap between my grandfather who was a lawyer and me was very large.
Okay.
So by the time I started law, he was not even around and therefore I did not really inherit a legacy practice.
Okay.
So I had to start from scratch and I chose criminal law. And I loved it. In fact, I did law to practice criminal law. So that
Seriously?
Was such a big passion. And I enjoyed myself thoroughly. So my first moment of pride, if you could call it pride, or just the happiness of recognition, was I was about 2 years in practice or something. And I walked into a court. And this was a division bench. Division means two judges are sitting there. And the senior judge from there literally shouted out to me saying, oh, there's Nappinai, come here. You know, if anybody would know about this matter, she would know. And then he said, Nappinai, this case was decided 2 days back in Supreme Court, tell me and all. Thankfully, I had read the case and I could tell him. But I can tell you, it put a lot of pressure on me to be really well read thereafter. And then it grew to maybe about 4 or 5 years into practice. And I was asked by a law firm to give an opinion on something, on software licensing and all that. That was in fact the beginning of my interest in cyber laws.
Okay.
And after I gave the opinion, that gentleman, the lawyer, told me that my senior had asked him to meet me and that my senior had told him if there is somebody who can give an opinion, which would counter mine, it would be Nappinai.
Okay.
And my senior was 72 years old.
Wow.
So that was a serious moment of pride. In recent times, I would say two things. One was when the Supreme Court appointed me as amicus curiae in a matter, and I was able to live up to that promise, and I think I delivered substantially, or at least contributed substantially to the matter. That was a matter of pride. And then when recently I was involved by a gentleman for redrafting one of the existing laws in India, and then when he met me, he said that he had read my book, and they are literally doing the whole recasting of these provisions on the basis of my book.
Wow.
I thought that was serious validation.
Fantastic, fantastic. So coming to your book, Technology Laws Decoded, how did this come about? It's become like a Bible for the cyber lawyers, I think, now.
I've been told that. Mm. And again, I'm very grateful for people who have said that to me. So I used to give a lot of sessions. So I've been training judges, police, giving sessions for, for industry for nearly two decades now. So when I said I was literally one of the first in cyber laws, it's, you know, it's that's the way it started. And everyone used to keep telling me that you make it seem so simple, why don't you write?
Okay.
I think I was just very lazy. So it somehow, you know, you have to see the amount of preparation and work I would put into each of my sessions. But when it came to writing, I still didn't do it. Finally, I should say thanks to one friend, a client turned friend, and the publishers. LexisNexis is the publisher of my book. There was this girl, Priyanka, from LexisNexis, who met me pursuant to a recommendation from my client turned friend. And I should thank her for pushing me and making sure that I finish the book. So they actually signed me up when I had just conceptualized the whole thing and all that. It was a 1 year process. You've seen the size.
Yes, I've seen the size of that.
So
I've seen the size and the price also.
Price is very low, I can tell you, for the quality of content you'll find in there.
Hardcover.
Hardcover. It weighs literally 1.5 kgs.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
I had to carry it somewhere, and I know it weighs that much. So it's thanks to her that I finally put down what all was there, and I was so happy. Because my entire journey over the last 20 years has been to share my knowledge in this field. And it's a growing field. I normally tell people that unlike regular laws, even say criminal law, where old bandicoots like me are there, here is your opportunity for youngsters to be in a field which is just evolving.
Okay.
So my idea was to share my knowledge for that.
You know, I've seen a lot of people doing this cyber law, certificate course, 1 year certificate course, and then saying that they're cyber lawyers and all. I think it involves much more because the cyber laws are getting more and more complicated.
Yes.
So what is your thing on, you know, doing a short-term course? A normal lawyer goes and does a short-term course. You think it makes sense, or going for such a person, and that person automatically charges much more lower. The chance of you winning the case also may be lower over there. So what do you think, what is your take on that?
Well, if you want a certificate, by all means, get it.
Hmm.
But remember, law is not about degrees and certificates. It's about knowledge and hard work.
Hmm.
You know, you have to read, you have to learn, and you have to be able to evaluate, assimilate, use your logic, and your, you know, it has to come from within.
Hmm.
So what I find a little disconcerting of late is that people just automatically assume that with the tag of expert that things are going to happen. It doesn't happen that way. Please put in the hard work that is also needed to back the tag.
Totally. Well said. Very well said. Okay, coming to a couple of controversial things.
I thought the dictator was the controversial one.
That is fun. You know, like, what is the big deal linking Aadhaar and social media accounts? I feel that half the followers, I think if somebody's got some 4 million followers on Twitter, it'll become like 1 million the next day. You know, half of them all fake accounts. I mean, you go and see the accounts, their eggs and all that kind of stuff over there. And actually at two Twitter conferences, when they had people, I said, why not link Aadhaar to social media? I think they've taken my idea from there. I'm going to
claim
some.
We have to blame him for that then.
And I feel it's totally, I mean, you can go and catch that troll over there. Okay, you are the person. So what is the big deal on that?
Yeah, you have the bot problem, you may have bots running things, you can figure out solutions for that. And I've already given sound bites on it, and I stand by that. One, this whole concept of linking Aadhaar with social media accounts is on the face of it wrong and violates the Puttaswamy judgment, where they've clearly said that private companies cannot ask for linking of Aadhaar, right? The second aspect of it is we are talking about social media companies. They're not just for India. Aadhaar is only for India. So what are you going to do about those other billion or so out there, several billions out there, right? Are we only going to talk about our 1.3 billion and say we don't care about the rest of the internet? That cannot be how the world will function. Finally, I have in fact written about this in my book also. I've called it in the name of security. And I've said, what are the things we are compromising in the name of security? From, you know, actually having true privacy. Today, we don't blink an eyelid when we are getting frisked, not just in the airports, but even to go shopping or for a movie. We don't really think twice about it. The second thing is we don't really realize how much we are giving away when, you know, we think convenience overrides privacy. And today, because you think you're scared about criminal elements out there, should 1.3 billion suffer because a few thousand or even if 1 million were to be committing violation? It should not be that way. The norm should not be we will assume you're a criminal and then you prove yourself innocent.
And coming to those 3 billion people who are there, 3 million people, most of them are bots from Afghanistan and Bangladesh and all bot accounts over there. All the social media guys will agree with me on that. So it actually doesn't serve any purpose. Correct. Okay. So how deep is the penetration of privacy in India? Is our fundamental right under risk?
Firstly, we have to understand that we have that as a fundamental right. How many of us understand that? Everybody seems to think that the Puttaswamy judgment gave us the right. It did not give us the right. It just recognized the right. The right was already there. But we have never understood the importance of privacy. You know, I mean, like I'm from the South. I did not like it even when my neighborhood mommy thought she could, you know, pry into where I was going, who I was going with, what was I doing and all that on a daily basis. But today, if a social media platform wants to do it, I don't care. And today it's a reversal of that whole process where I want to put it out there on everything about what I do. But the bottom line is actually two things. One is the government cannot be heard to say, you're giving this away to everybody, so why not to me? It's the government's job to protect me from others taking this kind of data away. And two, we can't always keep sitting around blaming others. We have to also take some responsibility for our own actions. So it's high time we also become a little bit more responsible in our usage.
So you have to say no to terms of agreement. Most of the time, you know, software agreement, this agreement, you don't know what all are you signing over there. And then, yes, I accept.
If you have to read all of it, half your lifetime will go only in that.
Then you get only
half a lifetime to use all those services.
Okay, Bitcoin's good or bad?
Well, as a good lawyer, I'll say it depends. It depends on who is asking the question, right? So if it's for the government, it's definitely bad. If it's for the person who owns a lot of Bitcoins, then he'll say it's good. So as a lawyer, I'll say it depends.
So you think there's a future of Bitcoins?
Well, why only Bitcoins? If we talk about cryptocurrencies, I personally believe that it's very difficult to sustain a future for them. The world is already, it went through a high. Everybody not only enjoyed the benefits of cryptocurrency, but also of derivative products. You had ICOs, crypto funds, and which was and whatnot. But you know where everything is today. The one issue which I feel that they have not been able to answer is, where is the underlying valuation? If you're not able to answer that, if it's a circular transaction which is creating valuation, then there cannot be a future for it and there should not be a future for it. Right? If you're talking about protecting the citizens and from the citizens' perspective, not just as a government but also as self-protection, you would want to know how secure is this? Who is going to secure me? Today, even when you take a 1 rupee note, you expect a governor's guarantee on it. You expect the government to back its valuation. But you're willing to speculate on something which otherwise may not have valuation.
Okay. Does India have the appropriate cyber laws to protect or punish their own citizens?
Why punish our own citizens? It should only first protect them. Let it punish the criminals wherever they are from.
But it is being used to punish also sometimes. I mean, they're taking up the laws in between the cyber laws which were there.
Yes.
It has been used to punish them also. But I think there's a ruling come against that.
Against which?
Against that. You remember the Facebook post which was there, those two girls, they were
absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So 66A was then struck down in Shreya Singhal's case. So I would say the laws are there. There may be flaws.
Hmm.
After all, when have we ever found anything without a flaw in it, right? But the problem today is not the lack of laws. I feel the problem is effective enforcement. Hmm. If we were to have effective enforcement, if we can be sure that if there is a problem and if I go give a complaint, then the police will take action, the culprit will be found, and therefore I'm safe. You know, and there is then a deterrent action.
Yes.
Unless that is there, then I have called it the broken windows theory in my book, Broken Windows of Cyberspace.
You do a lot of social work for people of the underprivileged. Now, tell us something about it. Related to cyber laws, not
to cyber laws. Yeah, okay. So I have been doing that as part of my practice even from the beginning. Earlier, it was in the field of consumer protection. One of my earliest matters, which I take great pride in, was when I represented, I think, about 2,500 slum dwellers and ensured that their tenements were not given away to some unknown elements and they were not cheated out of their rights and all that. But then now it's grown a lot in cyber. Over the last 2 decades, I've one, apart from the training and awareness programs and all, there is a reach out that always happens because I'm known in this field, so people would just pick up the phone and then ask for some help. So for one instance is when I got a call from a victim who said, look, I just had these compromising pictures in my computer and my father obviously doesn't know about it. It's in a locked folder and he took it for repairs and this person unlocked it and he has it. What do I do? And if I'm able to guide her. And within a week, she came back and said, everything is resolved. Thank you so much.
Okay.
You know, things like that. So it's an ongoing process. So now what I'm planning to do, and within probably a week or 10 days, hopefully, I'm planning to launch something called a Cyber Sathi, your cyber friend.
Okay.
So what I decided was if there are so many people out there who have these queries, which can be easily resolved with just one response, then why not create a platform?
Fantastic.
Which will provide that facility for free.
You patented it?
I have blocked the domain.
You blocked the domain. That's the starting point of everything.
Yes.
Right? Okay. So in child pornography, you are amicus curiae.
Yes.
Correct? My Latin is good, yeah. Versus Union of India.
So is your Tamil. You got my name right.
I got it. I practiced your name a lot. Okay. What was your journey like in the matter? And do you believe that we have sufficient laws to combat child pornography, which is a very big issue?
Yeah, so first on the law, actually, so it's very interesting. So India did not have a provision to combat child pornography to begin with.
Oh my God.
Then we got the POXO Act, which dealt with sexual harassment of children. And then we needed something specific for child pornography online, etc. We have some soft law, which is called a Budapest Convention, colloquially, or otherwise it's called the Convention on Cybercrime. That has this provision and it mandates that the signatory country should adapt it.
Okay.
India is not a signatory to the Budapest Convention.
Oh.
But to its credit, though it opposed it for other reasons, it adapted all the things that were good from the convention.
Okay.
And that's how when the 2008 amendments happened to the IT Act, 67B was introduced for combating child pornography.
Okay.
And India has one of the strongest laws against child pornography. So even browsing for it is an offense. It's just that we need more enforcement. That's exactly what I was coming back to.
Okay.
So in this case, the case started in 2015, but it was pertaining to uploading of rape and gang rape videos. And then in 2017, February, I was involved as amicus. The initial intent was to try and figure out technology-enabled solution, artificial intelligence-enabled solution, to try and identify such content even at the time of upload. Because my concern was that if content like this is out, forget about 36 hours, even if it's out for 36 minutes, it harms the victim more than even the first violation against them, right? So we started with that, and then the court appointed a committee, and I was part of the committee. It was all a consensual process. All the big social media platforms, search engines, and of course the government of India was also part of it. It was spearheaded by the Ministry of METI, Ministry of Electronics and Technology, and we gave about 12 consensus proposals, all of which was accepted by the court. So I think that was a huge leap from where we started to where we have landed now. Again, another happy moment was when I met somebody from one of those platforms recently, and he said, "We may not love you for what you did, but we respect you." You know, I thought that was a big thing. Bigger, you know, it's like you've made a difference.
Absolutely. There is a lot of cases which people may be seeing of deep fakes.
Yes.
So that is one big threat. Like they can take use AI, like they can take someone over there and take his what he's talking and make a totally different thing. They did it with Mark Zuckerberg, I think.
Yeah.
Deep fake.
Yeah.
So how are the laws going to deal with something like a deep fake? Or a lot of people, they take evidence and, you know, they manipulate those videos and all over there, which gets passed around on WhatsApp like anything without, you know, verification.
Yeah, but, you know, committing a cybercrime is also a very expensive affair. So we have to, one of the topics I teach regularly is electronic evidence. Okay. And in that, I've written a lot about it also, and I'm hoping that there'll be some changes for India's laws pursuant to those writings. But we have to remember one thing. You could create forgeries and fakes earlier also. It's not like you had to wait for deep fakes or electronic evidence to come to fake it, right? We still manage to deal with that. I call it the breadcrumb trail in my book.
Okay.
Like Hansel and Gretel's breadcrumb trail, here also the trail is always there. In fact, for electronic evidence, it's easier to find the trail than even regular evidence. It's just that, like the breadcrumb trail, it may not be there forever. So you have to act fast. So for every kind of crime, for every kind of manipulation of an electronic record, there is a methodology of finding it out. It's just that the person has to know where to look. And then they'll be able to do it.
Great. So that is serious talk now. So we come to quick gun jam, one witty answer. Curd rice or pasta?
South Indian, you're asking this, but strangely, though I would want to say curd rice with, you know, vadumanga, I would still say pasta. I'm a bad South Indian.
Okay. Tom Cruise or Tom Hanks?
Neither. Which generation do you think I belong to?
No?
Why not Rajinikanth?
That is too cliche. Yeah. You know, like Rajinikanth.
No. Okay, Rajinikanth or Ranbir Singh?
Okay, Rajinikanth or Ranbir Singh?
No, I said that it could be Rajinikanth or Ranbir Singh.
Okay, which one of them then? Which one of them? Both of them?
Oh, Ranbir Kapoor.
Okay. Chennai or Madras?
You know, when I grew up there, it was both. When we speak in Tamil, we'll say Chennai. When we used to speak in English, we'll say Madras. Of course, most of the time, the Tamilians speak in English. So it would be Madras most of the time. But now we have learned to say Chennai even in English.
English, okay. Like Mumbai.
Like Mumbai.
Okay. So social media, which platform you're comfortable and, you know, like safe on those platforms?
There is such a thing as safe platform? You are an optimist indeed. Well, but I am an old timer, so I am only on this good old LinkedIn.
LinkedIn, no?
Yeah, that also with great reluctance. So I had to be really pushed to even open an account there. And I realized I had to do it because I was doing a lot of international work at that time. So even if I were to reach out to somebody to say, oh, I need this help in, let's say, Azerbaijan, where, by the way, I've done some work on IP and all that. They would first go and check on your LinkedIn and only then reply to you. So I realized that I couldn't avoid all social media.
You're there on Facebook, but hardly anything. And also, she doesn't have a photograph on her WhatsApp profile.
Yes, I don't. And more importantly, one tip there. Don't be lazy, okay? Keep your social media only in one device. Don't put it in all the devices. That's how you're helping the linking. And that's how you're helping your tracking and tracing and whatnot. So I don't have any social media on my phone.
Achha.
I would only access it from my computer.
Interesting. Okay. So hobbies, tell us about your first hobbies and family. Tell us about your family.
Which one do you want? Unless family is my hobby.
Family.
Okay, family. So I have a very small and a very large family.
Okay.
So it's just my husband Arun and I. Mm. And Arun most of the time gets called Mr. Nappinai, by the way, which he's not. But yeah. So if you ask for immediate family, it's just the two of us. If you ask for the family, which is like a good Indian family, I have three elder brothers and their, my sisters-in-law, their kids. Again, here this side, Arun's side, I have two brothers-in-law, sisters-in-law.
Big happy family.
Big happy family, very close-knit and fun.
And hobbies?
Oh, hobbies. I can take the rest of the evening for that.
Oh my God, okay.
I just love life. And so I love everything about life. So I play sports, not just watch. Okay, music. I won't dare to say I sing, but I believe me, I used to sing, okay? And so sports, music, reading, movies, so you name it, I love it.
M.S. Subbalakshmi?
And traveling, of course, M.S. Subbalakshmi. If you make me sing one of her songs, I don't think you're going to make it home then after that. But there was a time when I could, you know? But yeah, so traveling right now is a big passion.
Okay.
So,
opens up your mind. And where do you see yourself in the next 2 years?
Well, I see myself for the next 10 years or as long as I live only in law.
Only in law.
Anything to do with law. It could be practicing in court, which it will always be, I hope. And I would love to be in court, whichever role I'm playing there. And I would love to contribute more to the policy making, the law drafting, and to international, developments. So, I call my life the path of least resistance.
Okay.
I flow wherever it takes me, but I'm so glad it's taken me in a nice journey, which has always had a touch with law.
Fantastic. So, do you think that Indian laws, cyber laws, are the best in the world?
It's nowhere near that.
No way.
It's nowhere near that.
I thought the way you were saying we are so good and all, we're the best in the world.
No, I just said we have something, but even that something has to be enforced.
Better. Which country has got the best laws?
See, you'll be surprised. One of the recent changes not so recent now, 2015, one of the finest laws I came across was Sri Lankan. Yes. So after they signed up for the Budapest Convention, they changed the entire gamut of cyber laws, and they have done a fabulous job. I remember when I was in my first or second year of practice, I attended this program for simple writing, something you would think is an oxymoron for a lawyer, right? But I have always kept those learnings till date, and I personally feel that the simpler the law, the better it is. And they actually live up to that threshold.
And I never knew something like Sri Lanka. Wow.
Exactly. We never look that close to home. We would always look west. Maximum we would look east is Singapore. They do have some good ones, but Sri Lanka was a huge surprise for me. So I was teaching Sri Lankan judges, and therefore I had to do an in-depth study of their laws, and I was very pleasantly surprised.
So even though we have Ram, they've got Ravan, they're better than us, yeah.
Well, you're forgetting Ravan's kingdom was actually a substantial part of India too.
Don't say that now, because something is happening. We are annexing another thing where I don't want to annex them also. That will be edited out of the group over here. Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you.